from HackGT, one of the founders and directors, and we've had two so far, both of which I have been developing, founding and directing. I'm about to graduate, so we have just passed the torch to our two awesome new co-directors. But yeah, my buddy Pav and I founded the organization back in 2013 after MHacks 2, which is when I realized, you know, these things really start happening at Georgia Tech and beyond. So, you know, been involved in both of those. Kind of, sort of, mentored and volunteered at a couple other hackathons around the U.S., but I've been to a bunch and always help hacker in need. So. Favorite animal? Emperor penguin. Like the coolest looking goofy animal on the planet.
That's good. Hi everyone, my name is Marty. I'm a sophomore from Purdue. I'm the sponsorship lead at Boilermake and president of Purdue Hackers. I went to like 8 hackathons last year, so I just got like a shit ton of experience. Boilermake is like an awesome hackathon. If you guys haven't been, you really should go. Super excited to be here to talk to you guys about anything I can share. Favorite animal is probably a bird, even though they're not.
Like a couple animals, one. Hey guys, I'm Connor. I was the logistics director at MHacks 6, and I've been on the MHacks team since MHacks 5, so this is the third MHacks that I've been here to work on and help out with. My favorite animal would be a koala.
Well, hey everyone, I'm Poppy. I am a junior here at Michigan, and I was the user experience director for MHacks 6, and I'm currently on the team for MHacks Refactor. So I guess I've been involved in 2 hackathons. Besides that, I've been to a lot around the country. I've either like volunteered or like tried to mentor. I know I remotely mentored for Technica, actually. And my favorite animal is an owl. I know I have a cat face on, but it was easier than an owl.
Hey, what's up, everyone? I'm Tyler. I was the sponsorship director for MHacks 6 with Connor and Poppy. I'm a sophomore here at Michigan, and I was on the MHacks team for 4 events, including this one. So before I even came in as a freshman, I was under Vikram's reign. Yeah, and then, I don't know, what else?
Favorite animal.
Favorite animal is an orca whale.
Hey everyone, Anthony. I'm a junior at the University of Maryland. I'm the director of BitCamp this year. Last semester, I organized volunteers and mentors for Technica, and then the semester before that, I did some web dev for BitCamp. And my favorite animal is an octopus.
Hi, I'm Izzy. I'm from the University of Maryland, too, and I was the lead for event details for Technica, and I think I'm sort of on marketing for BitCamp. And I'm also co-directing a new hackathon that's coming out called Spectra. It's all ladies on the West Coast. Look out for it. Just some low-key marketing. And I've been to a handful of hackathons, and my favorite animal is the teacup pig.
Nice. Cool. Great. Well, there's a lot of really good animals, and a lot of really experienced hackathon organizers. So, how many of you have organized a hackathon before? Any of you? We have a couple, great. And a lot of you obviously are interested in organizing more in the future. So I want to start off with a pretty broad question that I think will open up a lot more discussion here. You know, there's been a lot of talk in general about what makes a hackathon successful, right? Is it like the space, is it the people, is it the, you know, awesome puppies you bring out, right? Like, although there's a lot of different elements that go into organizing a hackathon. And I'm curious, like, from all of your perspectives, since you organize a pretty wide variety of events, what do you feel contributed the most to making your event a success? And if you could extrapolate on that a little bit, I think it would be helpful. But I know this may take a little thinking, but was there something that really made your event stand out and feel more successful than you had imagined it to be?
I can start.
Yeah.
So Boilermake, if you guys know, is around 600 people every year. So it's not one of the biggest hackathons. However, one thing that differentiates us is that we have one space for everyone. That includes sponsors, hackers, and we've been complimented by sponsors and hackers that like this makes like a huge difference in the event because everything's inside. It feels like a community gathering for 36 hours. People just absolutely love it. So that's huge for us.
Yeah. I know BitCamp has similar setup as well.
Yeah, Technica as well.
Yeah.
Stadium style, or like one gym room, and then
both we set sponsors up in like a circle around the hackers, and then since sponsors and mentors, there's a lot of overlap, they're also all the way around. And then we'll have like a central area for gathering for big camp, that's the big campfire. It's at the center of like the arena, and it's where stuff happens.
So for HackMSU, I would say that like the first year, it was pretty much thrown together in like under 3 months, and it was just like, all right, throw the event, get some hackers here, and that really kickstarted a lot. And what we wanted to do with the second event, and this goes into what I think makes a good hackathon, is we had a vision for it to kind of kickstart the broader Florida community. And so when we were thinking of how to run the event, we would always think back to that of, okay, we want there to be a good community feel, right? So we encouraged hackers to wear like their school wear when they showed up so that they started building that like on the travel up. And then what we wanted to do this year was really create a creative environment for the hackers so that they could feel like they could build anything, right? And so a couple different aspects of this is we had a lot of design like oriented things throughout the event. So we had a since like for hackers design isn't really I'd say it's not a main focus right now, but it's coming up in like the industry as design oriented companies are really making headway. And so we had a tech talk on how to use Illustrator and creating badges. We brought up a creative agency in Orlando called Purple, and they were awesome. They had a graphic designer and UX architect, and they went over a ton of their portfolios and like process of their work. And then after that, we had a branding competition where students had like an hour to create a brand for these two places, a pizza shop and a clothing store. And like those three events, like each of them created a lot of conversations with the hackers alone, and then the hacks we saw at the end of the event were definitely more polished than we saw than previous years, and so things like that. We had a what we called a pair lounge because we had Apple, so we had the Apple lounge, so we made a pair lounge, and we held the branding competition in there, and we held a women in tech discussion in there, and it was kind of like a fun lounge space for the hackers to be in. And then something the team thought of day of was the top floor of hacking. They grouped together all the tables and in one pile and all the chairs in another and wrote on a whiteboard and was like, create your own space. And the hackers really took to this and then just moved like all the furniture in the library, which the venue didn't really like, but it was awesome. So I would say having a vision for your team, where you're all on the same page of, okay, what is this event going to accomplish at the end of the weekend? What do we want the hackers to really believe in at the end? And then just carry that through all of your decisions.
Yeah. So a couple of you mentioned the idea that you were trying to create a really community-focused space for Hackathon. You specifically mentioned creating like excitement around Florida hacking community. You mentioned like, you know, exciting people at Purdue and making a space that was really conducive to that. Hackathons are an interesting example of community building because they happen very quickly in a compressed period of time, right? You see someone for 24 hours and then maybe don't see them again for 6 months. But obviously a lot of the people at every hackathon are from your local campus. So how do you kind of take that energy that's generated off of a hackathon and turn that into a more sort of active hacker culture on campus between events?
I can start on this one, I guess. So with HackGT, we actually after myself and Tab and a few other hackers from our school had attended our very first hackathon, again MHacks 2, we realized that this is the kind of culture that we really want to build and sustain at Georgia Tech, which at the time in 2013 didn't really have much of this going on, as did most schools. You know, it was just kind of a new thing still. So one thing that we made sure to do was two things. So one was we started regularly contacting more and more hackathon organizers asking if we can get buses, you know, for our school to their hackathon. So the very next one we went to was like Hack 2, a month or two later. And then from there, we made sure to go to at least two every single semester. And the other thing that we tried to do regularly was consistent hack nights to promote and encourage the culture to continue. And a lot of that is sustainable. If your hackathon organization is the one that's also in charge of, like I guess, maintaining the hacker community at your school, One thing I very highly suggest is when you raise your budget for your hackathon, overraise by some percentage, enough that you can use the surplus. There is almost always going to be surplus if you do this. Overraise and use the surplus to continue throwing events throughout the school year and, you know, comp everything. Like, make it super fun. Like, you know, bring in awesome, like, you know, food, hardware, whatever, and just make it a good experience that you can throw on like a monthly basis and, you know, bring people back to enjoy and, you know, enjoy all the cool things. So keep getting new people in, have them bring their friends to the next one. The community just grows from there. So it's just, it's kind of a cyclical thing, and it'll just grow itself. So.
So I guess there are sort of two parts the way I see it for MHacks. One of the reasons why we use the Cortex model is that so people generally will be hacking on the same types of technologies as you. So that's like the initial spark, right? You make a connection with someone that is interested in similar technologies or is learning the same technologies as you. And I guess the hard part is sustaining those relationships after the hackathon. There are like kind of multiple ways to do this. You could either just like keep in touch with them, but it's also kind of convenient if you both go to the same school to find this third party organization. We have an organization at Michigan called Michigan Hackers, and they're super cool. They always try to send a bus to like neighboring hackathons, so very similar to what Shiru was saying. But yeah, again, hack nights, buy size, like they're always good. Just like different things to sort of get people together in a room and just like build something. I feel like generally with so many hackathons going on, and that's great because hackathons are great, people start to forget just the magic, I guess, in just building something, no matter how simple it is. But like building something and learning something for the first time. And I feel like these smaller events are really good at fostering that type of community.
So you brought up a really interesting point that the goal of hackathons in many ways is to foster learning and building. But I mean, I've certainly seen a lot of different approaches to that. The Cortex model is an interesting one. Having a lot of mentors is an interesting one. Having different software systems to encourage, like, you know, peer mentoring is a pretty successful one. But like, when you're thinking about organizing a hackathon, how do you actually make it a welcoming environment for beginners? And on top of that, how do you get people who are not in the hackathon community involved in your events? Because obviously, like, the easiest marketing channel for any event is the hackathon community that already exists. So those are the two sort of tied together questions. I'm curious what people think.
I can speak to MHacks 6 personally, which I think is something we did fairly well. I don't really believe in super targeted marketing, where I think like the type of marketing that's most successful is just trying to be as open and inclusive as possible through your copy, through like your design, through just the vision of your hackathon in general.
What's an example of that?
So something we tried to do and we tried to really push for MHacks 6 was the idea of beginner workshops, which we're actually like, continuing at MHacks Refactor. And the idea was that people would go to these different workshops. We had one for each Cortex, actually, so like iOS hardware, web dev, Android, and I'm missing the last one, and I can't think of it right now, but we had a fifth one as well. The idea was that you would start in these one and a half hours to 2 hour workshops, create something that you could ideally continue on for the rest of the hackathon, and then the idea was that you would go to the Cortex and like meet other people there and like continue working on it. Sometimes it didn't work that way, but people still got this really cool experience from going to the workshop. So that's something we tried to push. In terms of getting people from different majors, that's always like a little harder just because the stigma around like hackathons in general is like, oh, I have to be like a computer science student to like do well or something like that. A lot of that is easier if you start from within your own school first. There's a lot of like personal outreach that you can do. I find it easier to reach out in person because I'm better at the face-to-face interactions than emails and stuff.
The things I've found beginners worry about the most from fielding questions this year, when it comes to the event, they want to know, like, are they like the only beginner? Usually the answer is like no, like 40% of our registrants will be beginners. So showing them that they're not alone being a first timer is important. And then they come in, they ask me, do I need to have a team already? So making sure that you can communicate that, like, you'll have team building, that a lot of people are in the same boat. I think a lot of people are just worried about, like, not fitting in the same way they would be with any other event. So part of, like, being welcoming to newcomers who might not know how it works is showing them that there'll be opportunities to meet people and make teams at the event, that there'll be beginner workshops. There's ways for them to get started. They don't have to come in with a lot of experience, but they don't know that necessarily from what their perceptions already are of what a hackathon is.
Yeah. On site at the events, what has been an interesting learning about how beginners fit into your hackathon?
So at, I guess I can talk a little bit about that. At MHacks 5, we tried something where you could add a fifth team member to your team if they had never been to a hackathon before. And that was mainly to try and introduce them to the community and get them working with an experienced team so they could basically get the understand how to hack at a hackathon. That didn't work that well just because some teams had big ideas and then the fifth person just kind of watched. And that didn't really foster the newcomer to the team very well. So then we decided not to follow through with that at 6 and instead tried to promote more of the meetups, and like at MHacks Refactor there's blueprinting, and those types of meetups where people can identify themselves with different groups and different skill sets, and just kind of facilitated that talking process. And I think that worked out better because then it helped people meet people with the same skill level and not try to just assimilate them with more advanced hackers and make them almost feel worse that they weren't at the same level. Instead, they realized that there are a lot of other people at their same level.
Yeah, so something that I think is interesting, actually, I just experienced it like 2 hours ago, which is really cool. But I think sometimes beginners almost add the most value to your hackathon, and a lot of that value can be obtained by going and interacting with them, like physically. Not you as an organizer, you don't have time, but getting at least like a core team member to like facilitate conversation with them. So like they bring back these ideas that are so simple but like so cool and so innovative. And I just think talking to them and helping them work through their idea and making them realize that, like, you know, you can actually make this in 36 hours. And facilitating that confidence, I guess, is really key. And a lot of that comes from, like, one-on-one interactions.
Actually, I can second that. No matter how big or small the hackathon you're growing, even if it's, like, 1,500 people, you should still make the effort as best as you can to establish one-on-one relationships with as many people as possible. Like, get to be their friend. Be like, hey, you know, like, welcome to, you know, our hackathon. I was, you know, in your shoes once. I hadn't built anything before. You know, I'd love to, like, talk through, like, your idea sometime, help you kind of brainstorm how to approach it. Oh, these are some cool, like, APIs you can use. I'll show you how to do this. Or, like, these are some cool online resources that I know of. Or talk to this person, you know, this person building a similar idea. Make sure you kind of establish that one-on-one, you know, relationship. Because those are the most important things. Those relationships are what's going to keep your community growing and sustainable. And that's what's going to really, you know, that's where everything really shines, because then they understand the value of the community and turn around and help, you know, grow themselves. So, one-on-one relationships for sure.
How do you find the time to build one-on-one relationships in the chaos of a hackathon?
I have a lot of volunteers.
Yeah. So how do you kind of integrate volunteers into the structure of your hackathon?
I guess I can speak to this one again. I mean, we have a couple of hacking team members in the audience right now, but so a couple things that we do. One is on the sponsor side, we make sure that there's a volunteer. Like we kind of have like volunteers in certain, at least like assigned to at least a couple of sponsors, making sure they're passing by, like, you know, as little as every 10 minutes or, you know, maybe like every half an hour, like regularly enough that the sponsors feel like they're at home. Like, hey, do you need anything? I get to meet these people. I'd love for you to meet these people or something. Making sure the sponsors are always, like, they always have somebody they can, you know, reach out to and contact in case they need anything or in case they just want to talk or whatever. And then on the hacker side, the same deal. The more volunteers you have and the more, like, passionate volunteers you have, the more people, you know, can run around on your behalf and establish those relationships and become friends with people. So.
Yeah, sure. How do you, so want to know how you get sponsors and how you decide on what sponsors to get.
We'll get to that a little later, but we'll also have a period for Q&A at the end as well.
I can touch on the volunteer aspects. So for us, to get people that wanted to volunteer that work on the like core organizing team, we look to our student group Technol, and these students are already in the community. They've probably already traveled to hackathons with us before, and so they get the community aspect, that one-to-one, and it's much easier to get them to go around and talk to hackers than someone that's jumped on the organizing team and isn't quite sure. I'd say we had good feedback on that. Our volunteers were very friendly throughout the event, which is super great. And I'd say for that, definitely have maybe a little powwow before the event when you're setting up, and then also halfway through at least, so that you can get everyone on the same page, give that sense of community to the volunteers and organizing team as well. For us, we didn't really differentiate. We just called everyone crew, like if they were organizer or volunteer.
Cool. So I want to transition a little bit into that whole dirty secrets thing that we teased you about. But what was the most difficult part of throwing your hackathon? What when you were starting out at the beginning, what was the biggest blocker for putting on your event?
Okay, this happens every time you throw a hackathon. It's hard to turn people down. Because like, there's so many people that will apply, and you have to like say no to hundreds of people that you think would be awesome applicants at your hackathon. And that sucks every time. And there really isn't like a great way around that, which sucks.
More hackathons.
More hackathons, I guess, yeah. But that's like something that hurts every time.
As a counterpoint to that, the camp doesn't take applications. The way we do it is we know about how many people won't show up, and then we close the registration. So we do have to, at a certain point, say we go on a wait list, but there's no like application process. There's no, it's completely impartial. And I think there's a lot to be said for that method, because you can't really get fair, and, you know, it's first come, first serve, up until like the day of the event, and then we allow walk-ons up to their capacity of our building.
Isn't that skewed towards people who already know about hackathons?
Right. But, I mean, I don't know how, I'm not sure how you would measure whether you have more people that don't know about hackathons signing up in the period between when we have to close registration and when we start allowing like walk-ins, versus if they're going to see it before then, during the walk-in period. I think most of our beginners tend to come from the campus, people that like their friends convince them they come and they have and then we can miss them,
you know,
probably
good
hackathons as well.
We're going to have to hear Q&A at the end.
Okay. Yeah. I'd also say, though, that I think hackathons that do applications also close it at a certain point, right? So that they have a period to give out acceptances or wait lists. And so that's also kind of skewed towards that. And I think to fix that, if you can do a good job of, like, when you launch, just go hard and, like, shout it out everywhere. And kind of do it closer to your event rather than farther out, so that the hype of registration and friends telling their friends about it leads into the event. That's a huge like numbers game and very, very hard to get ready.
Yeah, I mean, no matter what happens, it's almost always 50% attrition. So whether you have them confirm, whether you have them double confirm, like you almost always lose 50% of your signups at the door. Pro tip, if you're organizing hackathon, sign up to twice as many people as you think you need to.
So two really big barriers to, I guess, continuing like planning for the hackathon. One is securing a venue, and the second one is launching a website. The two don't necessarily go hand in hand. So once, if you are still working on finding a venue, you can still be working on your website. It's not like you have to, you know, spend all your time working on venue, finish, and then work on website. That's one big thing that might help you get a lot done. It might basically make it a little bit more efficient when actually planning for a hackathon. When looking for a venue, have backup plans. Don't put all your eggs in one basket.
Just more like a general rule about that. We often found ourselves focusing on the most pressing aspect, and then we would fix that, but then another aspect would be just as pressing right after that. And it was just a game of catching up after that point. So you have to understand, like, for us, we have three directors. So we had to, like, not have all three directors in on one project. And that was a real hard, like, a really hard thing to get used to, just because, like, oh, we don't have a place to have the event. How can we think about anything else yet? But there are a lot of other things that can go on simultaneously that really should be thought about, at least just to have the process be done.
What was the hardest part about organizing Technica?
In all honesty, it was relying on some people to put the light on. I don't know if that was like, everyone else was really like, all right, okay, that's cool. So, well, the event details team was actually more than just one person, but it ended with just one person, I think it's just hard because we understand that everybody has classes and other commitments. So to really want to throw a hackathon, you really have to sacrifice part of your GPA, which I did. But what's really cool is when you get to people who are left over and they are so 100% for it. I love to feel like 100%
tested. That's true. How do you know who the right people are to organize a hackathon?
So,
actually, that's something we're running into trouble with perspective. There's a lot of people who are interested in like organizing a hackathon that we posted and said, hey, who's interested? And it's hard to know, because everybody's got so many skills that they've been into planning, it's hard to know how many of them actually have the time that they come to it, or whether they actually are available, because we're planning on the West Coast. A lot of logistics that are within the actual organizer team that's kind of hard to manage. Actually, Amy's on my team too.
By being here, all of you are now qualified to run a hackathon. So congratulations, you're certified. But seriously, there's always a lot of talk about like how to pick your team and who's gonna run the hackathon and who's qualified or not. But like the truth is, none of you had any qualifications before you started running your hackathon, and so diving into it is honestly the best way to start. And time is going to be your biggest factor, honestly, because there's a learning curve no matter where you start from. So none of you mentioned this as one of the more difficult things about running your hackathon, and I know for a fact that it's a very difficult thing about running your hackathon, and I imagine if any of you have started the process of trying to run your own, that you probably run into this. What was it like working with your school administration?
That was one of my, that was like basically my key role as logistics for MHacks, and working with the school is not a fun process because mainly they've never seen an event like a hackathon. So really you have to sit down and explain, people will be in your facilities. One, like trying to sleep, eating, like bathing basically, and just living in your building for 48 hours. And that just makes a lot of facilities managers really uncomfortable, because that's a lot of liability that they have. So it was like by now we have the school mostly on our side because we've done it a few times. It's still working with like fire code and all of that. Is the school's a really big bureaucracy too, so in these buildings there's four different managers. So I have to talk to four people in order to get this space, basically. And then they all have to report to someone else. So it takes time. You can't expect approval within a day for anything. And that's the big thing, is thinking of things that you need approval for more than a week in advance, because it will take at least a week to get basically anything approved from your school. And that's one of the biggest things, was just working around with all the people, and because honestly, a lot of the people just don't want to deal with it because it's a lot of work on their part setting it up for us. And that's just another issue, and because we're all students. But the big thing is getting the timing right and explaining to them what a hackathon is. And MLH can be a big help with that, because they've just done it so many times that they'll feel a little safer if they know you're backed by an organization such as them.
That's And we actually talk to school administrators pretty frequently about that kind of stuff too. We know a bunch of the MHacks admins, Michigan admins now very well.
Find a few key staff members who are like on your side, convince them, because then they'll help pull strings and everybody everywhere else. For us, like our general school administration was very slow, it was not for it. But our college community specifically was like, oh, this is dope, like let's make it happen. So you know, buddy-buddied up with them, that helped us make things happen. Granted, they still have their own bureaucratic stuff involved, like Georgia Tech has something called the Corporate Affiliates Program. And so they're like, oh yeah, you know, if you become like an official organization with the school, like a chartered org, you know, help with funding and pizza. And I was like, oh, that sounds cool. Like, you know, maybe that could work in our favor. And they were like, yeah, we need like 10 of our sponsors to give you $500 each. I was like, that's not what we need. A lot more than that. A couple orders of magnitude higher than that. So we formed a nonprofit. We totally operate outside of like the bounds of the school financially. So
That's another big
you can
one.
Move
is
way faster if you do that.
You have to read up on your school policies.
Yeah.
Because schools just aren't designed for events of this magnitude and time length.
Yeah, I think we spent like 2 months.
That arc run by the school.
Right.
Yeah, we spent like 2 months over the summer reading up on like just all the things having to do with student organizations and working your way around that. Also, something that I touched on earlier was finding like a key program in the school or a key organization that where there's a great symbiotic relationship between the hackathon and the unit within the university. Where you basically support them and they support you, and having your into the university is really helps close the doors for a lot of other opportunities. Like the Center for Entrepreneurship, like, if we didn't have them, this event probably wouldn't happen.
Yeah, definitely, like, when you know you want to throw a hackathon, just start trying to set up as many meetings as possible. To start meeting, like, deans or anyone you think could be important or who could care about your event. And you will like find some people. Like at the beginning when Diva Hurtado founded HackFSU, and she almost switched the name to HackTLH because of the lack of support we were getting, which we've been able to fix since then. But it's definitely still not to the level we would want. And definitely like year after year, it gets better after you can show like, hey, look at all these students we brought in. All of this is like PR for your school, and if you can go and create stories and show them data and bring that to administration, it helps. But it's definitely rough when it's they've never seen this kind of event before.
You mentioned PR and data and showing like how successful an event is. What motivates a school administrator to support you?
So, for example, Apple used to not come to Purdue. They came like once 10 years ago. Recruiter had a bad experience or something, and then they just didn't come anymore. And then our first director reached out to Apple, he's a very charismatic person, convinced them to come, and now like he's there 3 times a semester, loves Boiling, says he'll be there like every time. And to like be able to tell our school like Apple is here all the time because of us, that's huge. Just bringing in companies that like don't already come, it's like one small thing.
Yeah, for specific departments, if you can show how many of their majors that you got to go to this event and show how much they're learning, that really helps. Because the departments really care about their students, right? And so if you can play to what they care about and what they're working on day to day, you'll definitely be able to get more help.
Yeah, if your event also takes minors too, you can also talk up sort of the whole admissions portion. Like, if you bring minors to your school, they'll see how awesome your school is, and then therefore they'll apply. That's also another angle.
So I want to transition a little bit. I'm going to leave about 10, 15 minutes for Q&A from all of you. But before that, let's talk about money. You asked earlier about sponsorship. This is obviously an extremely in-depth topic that we can talk about. We can have an entire panel about hackathon sponsorship. But I just want to start out, why do companies sponsor hackathons in your experience? Because this is, you know, not everyone here has organized a hackathon before, but like, what is the key motivating factor for someone like Disney to come out and sponsor an event?
There are like two big reasons companies sponsor hackathons. One, to recruit, and two, to show off their technology. And like themselves. So you have to figure out what companies want. It's usually just one of those two things, and then just hit them hard and sell them. And then put a price tag on them.
how do you get companies that don't typically get involved with your campus to come out to your hackathon, right? Like, not every school is a top CS school, and so companies that are recruiting CS students don't typically go there. How do you convince them that this hackathon is going to bring out those people?
Sometimes it can be like a unique value proposition, like a 50-50 generation and all-female hackathon. It could also just be something like the experience of your team, or like the size of your team, and also just like coming across as professional too, and like looking polished and knowing your shit really goes a long way. Those are sort of my...
Well, let's get back to the core question here, right? Like,
yeah.
For a first-time hackathon that's not at a top CS school,
yeah,
how do you prove to companies that's worth giving you money and coming to your event? Because their time is almost as valuable as the money they're giving you.
I think from just like, I've been to a few like first-time events and smaller events, and they definitely tried to hit their local companies harder first just to gain a little bit of credibility. And because your budget won't be as large because it is your first event. So hitting like around, for us it would be like the Detroit area and Ann Arbor, and hitting all of those startups that can't pay to have someone live in the area, so they would want to find local talent, and then also just to get their name out because they're a growing company. I think that was, I've been to two really small hackathons, and both of them generally had the smaller companies, and then you can, once you have a base of companies, you can kind of use that to launch into other companies.
Matt, I know you had some like interesting experiences with
this. Like definitely local sponsors are huge when you're first starting out, especially if you're not a big name school for CS. And Devo ran the first HackMSU on $9,000 and then a ton of income.
How many people was that for?
And it was for 180 people, 24-hour hackathon. Yeah, so like we still don't know how she did that. And so it's really, if you can, like whenever, also when you're buying stuff, whenever you get a price, be like, oh, that's not gonna work. Like, can you do like 10% off, 15% off? Like, if you're working with, like, you know you're not gonna be able to get a big of a budget and you're getting to crunch time, look out to those that are in your local area, and they're gonna be there, that really care about boosting the community, and rope them in, and you could do something like, okay, if you come in at sponsorship at this level this year, we're gonna be 2 times bigger next year, and we'll allow you to come in with more perks at the same level. And really sell them on, the team is huge, and like that, like what you're going to accomplish is going to benefit both of you.
Yeah. To give you all some context around why everyone started laughing when he said it was $9,000 for 200 people, typically, a hackathon is going to cost anywhere from $75 to $100 per attendee to put on. So that's normally what you're looking at. So like $9,000 is like an order of magnitude less than that. But honestly, if you look back 5 years, that's pretty typical. Prices have gone up a lot as the number of perks and the quality of the food has gone up, honestly. But yeah, so when you think about like sponsors, right? I mean, think about how to get sponsors to your event. What kind of strategies did you use to reach out to companies that you may have never been connected to before?
Cold emails, and then as soon as they respond, get them on the phone. Like, get them on the phone, because email, you know, they can just ignore it. They can just be like, oh, schedule a phone call for like 3 weeks from now. Or, you know, let's like, they'll just email you at your own, you know, at their own leisure. Get them on the phone and talk to them, explain to them, be a human, you know, one-to-one relationships. Best way. That's honestly a really, really, really big deal.
Yeah.
I'm sure this is worth a lot.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, I mean, like, Tyler did sponsorship, but, like, I have my little, like, sponsorship tabs, I guess. So, again, like, I really don't like cold emailing, so I totally identify with people that don't prefer that either. But then you just have to be really mindful of all the connections that you make, like, everywhere. And just like remember people's like names and everything like that. So and just really be mindful of your network, I guess. And those will be the people that you can that they can provide like an in to their company.
Yeah. Okay.
For your hackathon, your network is your network.
Yeah.
And it's funny because like after you do one, you're like constantly networking for like everything after that. Even if you're not trying, like I go to career fair not for like myself but for MHacks.
Yeah.
Like true story.
Yeah. basically like just treating them like really like well, like treat them like your best friend. The happier they are, the happier you will be. So just really treat them nicely. Kind of goes without saying.
You always know people who know recruiters. Like you're always one step away. Like, oh, you have a friend who interns in this company. You ask them, like, oh, hey, can you like intro me to the recruiter? And then there you go. Like, it's really helpful. Also, email validators. If you can't find, I'm not even joking. Like, if there's a company out there where you just can't find anybody's email from there, go to just Google an email validator and guess combinations of the first and last name and numbers and dots. And one of them will almost always be a hit.
Yeah, Reportive is a good Gmail extension.
Yeah.
If you just type in like an email, then it can show you on the side of Gmail like their LinkedIn profile,
right.
So that's if it matches. So
it's very sneaky, but that's like
it's really useful.
How did you all get comfortable with the idea of asking strangers for thousands of dollars?
I think what really helped was that we were super passionate about creating a hackathon for beginners, specifically geared towards those who identify as female. So really talking that up, like that's a mission, and like telling sponsors that we care about girls who want to learn how to code, and sponsors see that as like, one diversity thing. But you know, it's an opportunity for them to get to know hackers who want to start.
I think if you research the company before you identify a company that you want to come and you research them and you find what their interests are, what their goals are as a company, and you can fucking align with those goals. Once you get the conversation started, it gets a lot easier to just ask them for money. But first, really, in order to get a sponsor on board, you have to find what they're interested in and find what their goals are and really play to those. Essentially, I know it's kind of like simple to say, but if you hear what they want to do and you hear what they want to get out of your event and you actually like cater to that, then it really feels like
that. Sell me this pack.
what were your best and worst sponsor experiences? Don't tell us the name of the company for the worst one, but
one of them that came last year, I'm not going to give the name, but they just did not understand that this was not a career fair. They sent the recruiter, they didn't send any engineers, they didn't take their table down at Expo, which is really annoying. They basically thought it was a career fair, and I don't think that we would have to do that, because it's not. It's
what was the opposite? That was the best?
I don't want to get a name for this one either, but they sort of, I mean, Apple is a phenomenal sponsor every year. They bring 15 engineers. They're not here this event, but they've come to the past ones, and they bring like 15 engineers. They set up a lounge, an entire room. They have people on staff in the entire hackathon all throughout the night, and they are genuinely passionate about helping students build their hacks, which is, it's very simple to say, but you can see that in the eyes of every single engineer there. And when you have that devotion from a company, you want them to come back, and they're going to want to keep.
So that's an interesting like dichotomy you mentioned there, right? You said that the bad company was there with recruiters, they didn't really get it, and they thought it was a career fair, and the good company brought engineers who were awesome mentors. How do you screen and train sponsors with that behavior?
Anyone
else can talk to.
I was just going to say, when after you convince them to come to your event, talk to them about what they're going to bring, who they're going to bring, and really stress the importance of bringing engineers, developers. Just straight up tell them that they're not going to get much headway if they just have recruiters, and it's not because like the people that will be able to mentor them are going to make 10 times more of that one-to-one connection that we're talking about, and that really helps their brand if you make a connection with someone that works there. So I would just stress that in the conversations leading up to your hackathons.
Yeah, really, really work with them to like help them understand the vision, especially if they're a first-time sponsor who hasn't done this before. Like very, very heavily emphasize the fact that it's nothing like a career fair. It's like you're gonna be there for a whole weekend working with these people side by side. You know, they're gonna be their friend, not their.
If your hackathon focuses more around beginners and it doesn't have a quote-unquote lead hacker, then and some companies will be almost turned off by that. Like, well, if I'm looking to recruit talent, why would I send recruiters to a hackathon that doesn't have this elite hacker that I'm looking for? And the great way to sort of turn that on its head is by saying, if you send an engineer to a hackathon and you have them work with a student the entire weekend, help them struggle through this entire problem. This also goes for high school hackathons too, but help them struggle through a problem. When the student, you know, leaves that hackathon, they go to 10 more, and then, you know, it's time for them to look for a job. They're going to think of that company that helped them through that problem. And so, if you have your engineers be there with those students that are just beginning, that pays off in the long run when it actually comes to hire people in. That's something that people, that's kind of hard for hackathons to think about.
Yeah. Cool. Well, while I transition and give some time for audience questions, one thing I'll mention is that if you don't get to ask a question, all of these people are super friendly. You can come up to them afterwards.
I saw on Facebook.
Yeah, add them on Facebook. I would also highly recommend that you all try to attend HackCon. How many of you have been to HackCon? Like all of you. It's a student hackathon organizers conference. Next one is at the end of June in Boulder, Colorado. We rented out a summer camp. We're going to have toasted marshmallows. It's going to be great. But we have a lot of talks just like this about how to organize hackathons. Tickets are, I think, $150. They include 3 nights of like a hotel, basically. So it's basically free. Also, if you go to MLH.io, you can contact us and we'll help you organize your hackathon too. I think all of these events are MLH member events, so we are able to help you and provide a lot of resources. So, raise your hand.
One note on that was we were able to get our school, one of our departments, to help sponsor our flights out.
Yeah.
So that's definitely something to look into. Because it is a great
idea. Yeah. One other quick note about MLH, they have a great just like how to hackathon resource on their website.
You should
definitely read through. It's a great follow for any events.
Swift, the CEO, he's not here right now, but he also has like a bunch of really good webinars about budget, sponsorship, things like that. So,
I promise, they're not plans.
So I wanted to ask a little bit about MLH. In your experiences, what have been the advantages and disadvantages of partnering with MLH?
I've not seen any disadvantages while partnering with MLH. The big thing is we would have monthly or bi-weekly calls with them to basically just have updates and check in. And because they've seen so many hackathons, they know where you should be at and where good places to be at for what your end goal is. And just that structure of going from never having to like plan a hackathon before to having someone who's been to hundreds is just a great person to bounce ideas off of and just resource to check on.
At what stage or size of a hackathon do you think it is worth it to bring them in?
When you're starting up. I would, like, if you're just starting up, I would highly recommend going to college. Because you're gonna have questions.
Also, one of the like biggest perks I see is having like the two people on site. That's actually like super extremely valuable, because when it comes down to it and you have to make like a split decision and you don't know what to do, you have these people who have done this so many times before that they're able to make those hard decisions like much, much easier.
Also, they provide a hardware lab, which is super sweet. Provides lots of value to hackers.
Yeah, it's
all
free for you to do.
Also, another thing.
No one's had any trouble.
No,
absolutely.
The downside is that they don't send like hours. The whole team could come out.
Yeah.
No, they're like,
we have to feed you. Yeah,
so. Now, they're like, there's no reason not to work.
Also, another thing, if you're just starting up and no one knows about your hackathon, just having your name on the MLH site helps a lot. Because people will go there and just apply to all the goals and then not look at anything else. So to get your name out there, especially in that month as well. They've definitely gotten a lot of heat. Like, you've probably seen on Hackathon Hackers. Like, there's the Hackathon thing, whatever. But like, in Boilermaker experience at least, like, we've not had any trouble. And I think everyone here agrees that it's all we want.
And another thing you guys were able to provide us last year was we had, they put out a PR blast for us, and that got us a ton of like on the news, and like everyone in the community saw that Hackathon was happening. So that was.
I was just gonna say, I don't know how they do this, how they sustain it, but they respond to like everybody.
Yeah.
A lot of time.
Yeah.
Okay, so in the beginning, you guys talked a lot about how you can make this comfortable for first-time hackers, but how do you try and bridge the gap where you bring your hackathon open and people want to come there for the first time, but you also want to attract veterans who want to go and really push the boundaries because they've been there? How do you tackle both sides of that?
I have a lot of thoughts on that. I think that is a... it's not black and white. Like, some of the best hacks I've ever seen were from people who had never been to hackathons before. And so thinking that like you need to attract veterans to get great hacks is silly. Like, a lot of the most creative hackers are like brand new. So like, I would think less about newbies versus veterans and think more about like, how do you get different types of people who have different skills involved, and how do you encourage an environment where they're creating interesting things, right? Because you can have an event of all veterans that make boring hacks. You can have an event of all newbies that make. That's not actually how it works. It's not actually like newbies versus veterans. It's like, how do you create an environment where people are interested in pushing themselves and making something interesting? And that's the hard part.
I want to add to that, that you should always emphasize, especially in your one-to-one relationships that you're building with all these people, as you should be, you should make sure that it doesn't seem like a very intimidating like competition. Like, it's not about winning the prizes. A lot of new people will think, oh yeah, I'm not good. I don't know anything. Like, how am I gonna win all these sponsor prizes or any of them? That's like, the point is build something cool, and the prizes will come in time, like on a long enough timeline. That doesn't even matter. It's all about coming there and building something cool that you know, that you care about. So emphasize that over winning prizes.
Also, to directly answer your question, if you want to get veterans, go to classes. People need jobs. So I tell them there are gonna be all of these companies that are looking to recruit. And there are lots of juniors, seniors who like will need them. So just like figure out what they need for them.
Yeah.
I guess I think I would like to ask a question that responds to that a little bit. Over the past few years, I think the course of like hackathons, that's become I think a more common theme. People coming to hackathons in order to find jobs. And I guess I'd like to ask each of you sort of through the growth of your hackathon and standardization, like how do you find that sort of like, I guess, company appeal has changed your hackathon, and has it been for the better or?
Has your hackathon sold out, I think, is the TLDR?
No, I don't believe it's sold out at all. I mean, I think that like, you know, like Apple's pushing the forefront of technology. It doesn't mean it's sold out. Do you think the incentive of jobs produces better hacks, or do you think it like, you know, diminishes the quality? And how do you think it's affected your individual hackathons actually?
Or going off of that, also sponsor prizes and the fact that people get so much free stuff just for, you know, attending.
So I guess we can, to go off Sam's, I think the big one was, I mean, one of our large sponsor last time, we did get some flack for it because it was Walmart and it wasn't considered a tech company. And people did kind of view that as going for just a company that was there to recruit. But in the end, they ended up being a killer sponsor that actually was there to, they really sent a lot of developers to promote the hacking. And they didn't really do any like one-on-one interviews per se, but people do like to network at these events. And I don't know of anyone that, I don't know, I don't really think of going to a hackathon to get hired, but it definitely is an attraction now. But I think a lot of the events, the main attraction is still to build something, and then when you have an extra hour, there are all these people still there.
Yeah.
Funny quick story about that. At the very first HackGT, we had Cardlytics as our title sponsor, our partner sponsor. It's not really a company you immediately think right off the bat as like
being, you know, the hackathon type, like, startup-y, cool, hip kind of company. But, like, their CEO was a keynote speaker, and he came out on stage, and he was like, don't work for us, go build your own cool stuff. Like, he was straight up, like, it was very cool. Like, yeah, it was, you know, it turned the whole thing on its head. Like, they're cool people who understand that you can build cool things and go build your own fun stuff.
I'll add that, like, from talking to a lot of sponsors, the non-Googles and Apples and Facebooks of the world have like a chip on their shoulder, right? They have something to prove about how awesome they are. And so that's why you see companies like Walmart or Cardlytics or like companies that you completely never heard of sponsoring hackathons, because they want to prove that like they're good places to work. And honestly, a lot of them are, but they're just not as good a marketing engine as Google, right? And so like that's, I think for the most part, is an added benefit. You definitely get some duds, but like, honestly, the duds don't detract from the event, but the big ones that are really awesome add a lot.
We still need to answer the prizes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
So, if anyone else wants to. So I guess for prizes and free benefits, that is part of, just as John touched on earlier, why the like price of hackathons has gone up, because it has kind of deviated away from just the fact of building a community and building something. I think it does make, so our event, a lot of people can view as intimidating to a lot of people, and that's why beginners are often hard, because they don't feel like they can win anything, and they don't feel like they can do anything. So things that we kind of work around, we still do offer the prizes, but they aren't as, we try not to go super extravagant, and we try to, we've been slowly deviating away from, like, physical bot, or trying to deviate away from things that you can just go buy on Amazon, and think of cooler things to, like, that will inherently build upon your experience and create, cause you to keep learning. And I think those are the best prizes in my opinion. It's just, those are not always the easiest to come by to make sure people like them. So that's an interesting balance that's trying to be found with us at least.
And if you do have a lot of prizes, just don't mention all of them at opening or closing ceremony. We made the mistake last year, and it just, we would not do that again.
The thing with prizes is like sometimes it just ends up being like part of a sponsor like benefit, so that we're sort of like obligated to like give away those prizes. But what you can be creative with is your own like MHacks prize or like CAC prize and stuff like that. And that's where you make sure that people are getting things that actually benefit them. So like a script subscription to Adobe and like their suite of products, which is amazing. But yeah, things like that, it would just be like really cool.
Also, prizes are not a requirement.
They're also
they can't go our Technica Awards like in the first, second, or third prize. There's no prizes. There's some sponsored prizes because that helps generate more revenue from sponsors, but there's no prizes.
Yeah.
Also, like an in between, so something Boilermake started doing, which we got from Half the North, is not ranking people 1, 2, 3, it's going just top 2. And then that kind of helps because you're not saying like this person is better than this person, who is better than this person. It kind of like removes some of the competition. It's not like the best strategy, but okay.
So there's a couple dirty secrets I'll share with everyone who wants to organize a hackathon. First, judging is completely subjective. Throw out all of your assumptions about judging right out the window, because at the end it ultimately comes down to a discussion amongst the judges about which hack was cool.
Well, also paralyzed.
Yeah, I mean, like, even then, it comes down to a discussion among the judges about which one was cool, like, honestly. So don't worry about judging as a way to find the objectively best hack. There are other solutions for rewarding people for good work than trying to find the perfect first place hack, because it doesn't exist. The second thing I'll add, and this touches on Anthony's point, is that you have way more leverage against sponsors than you think. And if you can teach them that there's a better way for them to incentivize people to come talk to them or to use their API, then the prize is irrelevant. Like, sponsors use prizes as a way to incentivize people to work with their platform or talk to their team. But if you have a better way to do that, the prize is no longer important. Right? You know, it's just one solution for a problem.
Some of my favorite prizes, because your sponsors do have a lot of resources that you don't. And I think those are always like experience prizes are really awesome.
especially because if a company, if a startup that's in the area, you win their like best hacker, best prize or whatever, and it's just, you go spend a day in their office and get lunch with the team, like that's going to increase your chances of being with that team and working for them instead of getting a like huge light for them. And I think that's a big thing you can push, is because companies don't think of offering that stuff just because they don't think people want that. They think people will want like just a nice novelty item that they can like have. Whereas like our big company Walmart gave like flights to their corporation and gave like meals with the CEO and stuff.
It is a really easy shortcut to just sort of buy, like, ignore the whole experience prize and buying your own, like, annual prizes. And what Connor said is, like, don't take that shortcut. Really take some time to really develop these experience prizes, because that's what's going to stick with the hacker 10 years down the road, not just some, you know, watch that or smartwatch that they get, you know, and keep for the next year.
And one thing we did last year was we worked with MHacks, and the first place prize got a free flight out to MHacks, and so that kind of gives them another creative outlet and kind of promotes the community and shows everyone else that like, hey, this is awesome that they're going to a hackathon, and then it just kind of builds that. And I'd also say like that happened because we were friends with Vikram, and Vikram was like, yeah, and then we reached out to you guys, and you were like, oh yeah, sure. So I'd say definitely get to know other organizers. Like the best thing you could probably do is just after this is done, just start talking to everyone in this room. And it's huge for reaching out when you guys are having problems, because you're definitely going to run into problems organizing and hackathon. And it's a good network to build.
I want to add one more point on this before we move on to the next question. That on the note of judging being completely subjective, if you do have a lot of sponsor prizes, think about making a conscious effort behind the scenes in the judging room to distribute prizes as widely as possible. We actively try to do this at events, and attendees like you don't necessarily know that, but like it's way better if the first place team doesn't win five other prizes as well. If you can recognize four different teams, that leaves more people with a more positive experience, and they'll be more likely to go to more hackathons. So, like, think about that. The goal of prizes is to reward people for doing cool stuff, not pick a winner. Yeah.
So, I think, like, most of us in the room know that, like, what is generally, like, most of the projects done at hackathons tend to revolve around computing. So like it's all inclusive of hardware, software, mobile apps, like embedded stuff. But what about, you know, what about encouraging, you know, people who are people, or even just encouraging project ideas and actually doing such projects that have almost nothing to do with computing? Like for example, like doing like a fashion oriented hack that may have like very little like computing like features in it. And so by extension, how are you going to attract like those types of people, and by extension like the more like non-computing like sponsors, like more traditional engineering companies, maybe liberal arts type companies, that kind of thing.
Has anyone here been to Fashion Tech Hackathon at Kent State? Oh, it's really cool. There is a Fashion Tech Hackathon.
Yeah.
And also there's once in a while you see like non-computing hacks, like Sharek, who's here, built this portable shower once.
Yeah.
That was like, didn't have any electronics at all, but I don't know, what do you all think?
Yeah, like Sharek, there's a talk that he gave at HackCon that everyone should go on. And really, in the talk, he talked about what hacking is, and he broke it down into like hacking isn't even about coding, it's just about building. And so I think if you take that, and in all your conversations, all your marketing, just really bring it home that it's about creating. And it helps to, you know, show examples of the shower, tangible things that students who don't even know like what to build could look to as examples.
One shortcut is just send the bus to Maryland and have the terrorist hackers. Because then you'll get Shrek and you can create and all point. The other amazing hackers at Maryland.
Right.
And,
yeah. Right, but I specific like one specific point is like to like attract like people who are completely technically illiterate and have no intention on learning how to code or do anything other than what their area of expertise is, which may very well be something like physical. So like physical as in like maybe sewing clothing, like blowing up like mattresses or like air, that kind of thing.
Yeah, I mean, I think that like that's going to be difficult integration because people see hackathon as technology events in like a computing sense, and that I could see a million places where a mechanical engineer could integrate into a hackathon, or where someone who is, you know, like a clothing designer or an architect even could integrate, but like it's going to take a lot of work on their end finding their way into a team because it's not pre-scripted. And honestly, you're going to be hard-pressed to find a hackathon that caters to people who aren't into computing. I don't think that it's like off the table, but like that would take a pretty fundamental shift in how people look at like hackathons.
There's only so much you can do for a marine biologist.
But again, if they're into it and they want to go and they want to participate, they should be able to find people that will want to work with them.
Yeah. I'm going to actually... Do you mind if I make a response there? The winner to number 5 was a mathematician who actually hadn't coded before. And so she'd done some coding, but Poppy, do you want to continue this story? She brought actually into coding all of her knowledge from basically mathematics and like Fourier series and managed to solve a problem. How to take an image and learn to draw it, break down into its component steps.
There's an enormous amount of value to be gained for people who aren't programmers, but again, they have to like have that interest on their own to do it because the whole hackathon movement is not geared towards reaching out to those people, but they should come, I know you've had your hand up for a while.
Yeah. Oh, there's a totally separate movement called Makeathons.
Right,
and that seems to be the way to go anyway, is to just totally have a separate thing, because the logistics of having like the machine shops and all like the physical equipment is like just something that hackathons probably shouldn't have to do in addition to all the stuff that they already do. Yeah. I do have a separate question though. A lot of hackathons are trying to improve diversity in attendance. MHacks this time had like 50-50. I think the real test to see how that comes out is seeing how many people come back next year. But I was wondering, and this question is something I always find really interesting, is why do you think women in particular don't attend hackathons? And I would love to hear from the guys as well. That's really, I think, going to be the interesting stuff. But yeah, go ahead.
Sorry.
Yeah.
So, I actually did like a capstone. So, research aside, it's from what we learned from the people who, from the girls, ladies who attended Technica, a lot of it was just feeling like that wasn't a career path, or that to go to a hackathon, you had to be good already. And going in kind of blindly and having, like, thinking that you have to learn really quickly and it might not come naturally to you. Like, they think that it's, like, this is a mysterious, like, code that, like, they just won't get. It really affects whether or not they want to attend. So that's why Technica was super, we're for beginners. And the biggest thing that we advertised was our workshops, which were, like, basically throughout the entire event. Some girls finished their hacks, which were just made within the workshops, things like that. But I think what hurts is that,
research is always good because it's very compelling and persuasive, right? Because
so
it's data.
A study, I think it was Harvard, an economics professor noted that her students who are female who received B's versus males who received B's, the males thought, that's great. But the females found it, scary that they weren't receiving A's, so it was a more, a validation of some sort. So entering the tech industry is sometimes scary. It is actually, it's really scary. But I think what's really important is having a really strong community of women to include others. So that's why we really encourage beginners, do a lot of business, and English majors who came to Technica who learned how to do hardware hacks. I thought that was really cool.
there's two things I want to add here. We've done a bit of surveying about this, but the first thing that obviously has to be mentioned here is that hackathons are a reflection of the larger tech industry, right? And when you look at like the statistics of CS departments, hackathons are generally on par or slightly better as far as representation goes of demographics. And so there you have to dig into like deep societal issues around how people are guided towards different career paths, right? Like little girls are not necessarily given technical toys, right? Like that is a very, very deep issue that leads up to that. But ultimately, like most people are coming into college with some idea of what they want to study, and hackathons are a reflection of that. I think personally, one of the things that hackathons have a huge opportunity to do is to cater to people who aren't decided as to study in CS or not, right? Only about 65% of people who attend hackathons are CS students, and so there's already a pretty decent population of non-CS students, but I think there's an even bigger opportunity to get people who haven't thought about studying CS before, learning to code and getting involved in technology. The other thing I'll mention is that our surveying has pretty consistently shown that the number one reason why women in particular are deciding not to go to hackathons is because they don't know anyone. Like that is very, very consistently like the top answer for like, why didn't you go to a hackathon this season? It's like, none of my friends were going, right? And obviously that's a comfort level thing, but you know, it's something that there are strategies to address as well.
There's some things that are like, that you hear all the time. More often than not, females are the ones saying, like, I want a shower, I want a separate sleeping room. Also, one thing, I've talked to a lot of people about this, they love when they're like, you know the ladies store hackathon like group that's up? They're like meetups at hackathons, like, they love that. I've talked to a lot of girls who have told me, like, that's just like an A-plus in their mind when, like, they get to meet new people who are kind of like in that same.
I actually have to disagree. So we haven't seen any difference in demographics as to what people value at hackathons. So Wi-Fi or showers or anything, it doesn't vary at all based on demographics. That obviously doesn't reflect what marketing might reflect as far as attracting people to an event, but we haven't seen any correlation as to like different values in terms of like what makes a good hackathon.
Which is great, because then everyone can benefit from the showers.
Yes. Because of all the fun, it's really about the showers.
But I guess, to speak to this, so I actually didn't go to MHacks 3 or MHacks 4 because I was too scared to apply. And the only reason I went to MHacks 5 was because I convinced my friend to go with me. I was like, you like have to go with me. I want to go to this event, but I don't want to go alone. I don't want to find a team. I don't want to like not be able to make anything. So like I feel like generally this does happen with women, but it doesn't only happen to women. I feel like it happens to beginners in general, which is why at MHacks 6 I really tried to like push to be as inclusive as possible. But there's this sort of pressure, I guess, to be good, and like failure is sort of like not an option, or like you take it very, very personally, or like, so I don't know if you've ever seen the comic, it like kind of circulates around sometimes. No. I don't know. It's like the math problem one.
Yeah.
So like, yeah, it's, yeah. So like, there's like two sides to it, and like, there's a boy that gets a math question wrong, and the friend is like, oh, you're just not good at math. And then the girl gets the math question wrong, and then the guy goes, oh, girls aren't good at math. So it's that whole self-perpetuating like thing that if I went to MHacks and like wasn't able to make a hack or like wasn't able to ship something, that's just means that I don't belong in CS and I don't belong at like hackathons and stuff like that. So that sort of mentality is something we really, really try to push against in just sort of bringing back this whole idea that like hacking is about learning. First and foremost, it's about learning. It's like literally, if you leave, at the end of the 36 hours, if you don't build something or like if you don't ship something, that's totally fine. Like, we want you to ship something even if it's not finished, but as long as you had a positive interaction with someone, or like as long as you learn something new that you didn't previously know, like that's a success for us, right? And just trying to make it clear to people, I think that's one of the hardest things that like you're ever gonna run into. Like letting people know that it's okay, that you don't have to like build this, you know, machine that like gives you stuff to draw a picture. Although that's like super cool, but like that's not like, yeah, I don't know. Like there's a lot of stuff that
happens. We'll come other hands around here.
Yeah.
How could you best ensure or like try to ensure that like sponsors follow through with their promises in terms of like sponsorship money or any other person?
You could try to use your school for that. Like at Purdue at least, the moment we get a sponsor to commit, we pass them on to like Purdue staff who like immediately have like sent an invoice and like help us take care of that. That's one of the good things about having a school behind you. So they're not just like committing to a student, they're committing to like a university that they regularly probably. That's one strategy.
Oh, we just don't let them come if they don't pay.
Well, oh yeah, obviously if they haven't paid before then.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's
set deadlines, not contracts. A contract should be a given, but
yeah. After you get off the call with them, send them like a proposal. We call it a logistics package, but like just send them like a list of the benefits that they're gonna be getting, so they have a very clear outline of what they're spending this sum of money for. That's really key. Having deadlines on there, you know, price point, actionables. You give them a very like concise but very well thought out document, they'll be able to refer that over the course of the planning process, and that's how they usually stick.
And then also some of like the pre-event stuff you promised, such as social media posts and logo on your website and logos on the t-shirts, don't do those until you have the actual payment, and that'll rush the payment. And then if they have a deadline and know they won't get their benefits that they're signed to get, then that'll also go like push them to send it in.
Speaking of benefits, always under promise and over deliver. Don't give them benefits or say that they're gonna get benefits if you know you just can't give them or you're gonna forget to give them. So always stay with them.
I would say that like anything you discuss on the phone, get it in writing. And if you can get a signed contract, do it. But for bigger companies, it's gonna be a pain in the ass. Sometimes an invoice can suffice in its detail, but like make sure you have it in writing. And you know, once in a while you might have a situation where you have it in writing and the sponsor still doesn't follow through and pay, and you just gotta deal with that and when it gets to that. But like 99% of the time, if you get it in writing and they agree, you're good.
Yeah, I don't really want to do this with dead horse, but like, we actually had a situation at Six where a sponsor claims, like he was like arguing with me that his company had a talk at opening ceremony, and I told him, look at the logistics package that I sent to you 3 months ago, and he looked at it, and then he went and sat down. So, like, that's kind of how you resolve any conflicts.
Yeah.
We'll
get back to you. Yeah.
I know that you kind of mentioned you want to kind of keep your finances away from the university if possible. This is actually, I'm about a month out from my event, and this is an issue.
What is that?
GrizzHacks.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
We're hosting it at Oakland University.
Yep.
Any of you are interested in going, GrizzHacks.com. Anyways, you mentioned that like try and keep it away from the university, but as a first time event, how are you going to tell people like, give us your money, we're a group of students, we're going to put it in a bank account not associated with the university, and we're going to, like, how do you have any credibility with if you're not going to the university, but how do you deal with the university?
I think there's a pretty big mix here of who uses their university or not, right?
Yeah.
It's about 50-50.
What do you want to say?
So Big Camp uses the university, but we're also separate from the university. We have two accounts. We're having an account with the university makes it a lot easier to deal with university departments, because I think we should do an internal transfer. But having that external account makes it so much easier to deal with just everything.
You're recommending to put what you need to do internally with the university in the university account and keep the rest of it externally.
Yeah. For example, if you need to like pay for like housing expenses in the university, being able to do that through the university will make your life easier.
Right.
In order to get them to pay you, you need to just present yourself professionally. register your hack as an LLC. Pretty easy to set up.
Okay.
Nonprofit is better, but it's a longer process to do it, right? And then open a bank account.
So the one thing I'll say, though, is that BitCamp is a fairly established event, and having two accounts is feasible, but there's a lot of budgeting and invoicing magic that goes into that. And so I would highly, highly recommend start with one account. Either pick your university or pick an LLC and stick with it for the first event, because getting sponsors to put money in different accounts, depending on where you need money, is fairly complex.
Well, and yeah, at this point for us, it's a little bit too late to be doing this, but it's good information that would be for everybody else and for the future.
Yeah. Just make sure that you look, if you are an organization that is like technically part of like the university's tax code, the tax ID, really take a deep look into how your student organization is structured, or the system at the university is structured, because the last thing you want to do is create an LLC, create an external bank account, and find out that that's illegal. So just make sure that you take a deep dive into everything that goes into making a student.
Also find a CPA.
Yes.
Just offload everything on
there. Yeah,
please. But seriously though, be aware that if you start an LLC, the taxes are passed through to the members.
Okay.
And so you're personally liable for taxes on your LLC.
Okay.
And so if you make a profit on that sponsorship debt, you are paying taxes on it.
Which is why you want to maybe set up a nonprofit number and get a CPA.
So
just do it,
If you can do it through your university, it's gonna be a huge pain in your ass. But you won't have to do the accounting. Or the legal liability, honestly.
Yeah, I'd say like if you're just starting out, like I would definitely try to go through the university first, just so like you already have all these pressures of throwing your first hack, then you don't need to worry about like all these extra things. But yeah.
Yeah, I would agree on that, in that when it comes down to it, like the first hack was thrown in under 3 months. We pretty much just used what we had, which was a bank account with the school through a registered student organization. So like now we're looking into, okay, do we want to create a nonprofit? But you know, you just kind of do what you need to do.
Yeah.
Okay, kind of operating outside of university boundaries. You can move a lot faster.
Yeah. Also, so just one situation. I don't know if any other organizers have to deal with this. So for Boilermake, we have to go through the university. There's no other option. And the university actually takes 13% of what we
That's not even unusual.
It's a crap token. So Purdue has this organization called Conferences, and they're supposed to organize all the conferences that happen at Purdue. And Boilermake is technically a conference. And so we're paying them for them to like help us out, and that's like the 13% that they take. It's brutal.
How much help do they actually provide you?
Nothing. They screwed everything up that we did.
Yeah. Almost every university takes a 10% cut or more.
Yeah.
That's why
being out long.
I've heard the nonprofit is a dream, but I've also heard it's a nightmare. So.
CPA will help. You can talk about more in depth about this after, but any other questions?
Time wise, what's the shortest hackathon that you can pull off, with it being successful and having good hacks?
Probably 24 hours for the most part, but we do an event called Local Hack Day that's 12 hours. But it's not a typical hackathon, it's very different.
I would say 24.
What for high school students?